So good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Korea Society. I'm Mark Minton, the president of the Korea Society. This afternoon, we have a program that is a great pleasure for me to introduce, and it's a great personal pleasure as well, because our speaker is Dr. Park Jin. I have known Park Jin for 20 years, and first met him when I was a younger diplomat in Seoul, and he was certainly a young, quickly rising advisor in the Blue House. I was on my first assignment in Seoul, and I didn't find anyone in Seoul, even though he was rather young and junior at that time, who was more knowledgeable about the relationship with the United States, and indeed, sort of foreign policy generally, than Dr. Park. And I've been privileged to be able to maintain contact and communication with him for the last 20 years. And it's been throughout extremely beneficial to me personally when I was a diplomat and now as president of the Korea Society. I really don't need an introducing him to consult notes, except that he has so many different roles and has held so many positions and is such a Renaissance man that I don't want to leave anything out. So if you'll forgive me, I will briefly read his CV. He is currently the chair professor at the Graduate School of International and Area Studies of Hankuk University of Foreign Studies. He's also working as the executive president of the Asia Future Institute, an independent policy think tank. And the reason he's in the United States at the moment is that he is affiliated for the next month or so with the Wilson Center, Woodrow Wilson Center in Washington, D.C., working on Korean foreign policy, which is going to be the subject of his talk to us this afternoon. Those of you who pay any attention to Korean politics know that Dr. Park served as in the 16th, 17th, and 18th sessions of the National Assembly, representing the Grand National Party, and was indeed chairman of the Foreign Affairs, Trade, and National Unification Committee of the National Assembly, 2008 to 2010. He is a graduate from the College of Law at Seoul National University, the Kennedy School of Government at Harvard, New York University Law School, and received a doctorate degree in politics from St. Anthony's College, Oxford University. I think that must have all been before he was 25. I don't see how he must have started studying at universities when he was 12, but that's an impressive amount of education. He is a vice president of the Korea-America Association, a member of the New York State Bar, and is a regular member of the Seoul Forum for International Affairs. He has received an honorary commander of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire, CBE, from Queen Elizabeth II. We have with us a speaker who is more than qualified to talk about Korea's foreign policy, the relations with the U.S., and also the current dynamic in Northeast Asia among the countries of the region. I want to, in closing, thank all of you for coming this afternoon. I see many friends and distinguished colleagues in the audience. I want to especially note that the Korean ambassador to the United Nations, Ambassador Geun-hye, is with us this afternoon, as is Minister Yu of the Korean mission of the UN, who's back here. With that, it is my great pleasure to present to you for the talk this afternoon, Dr. Jin Park. Thank you.
Well, good morning. My name is Jin Park, and I'm very glad to Mark Minton for introducing me with such a long explanation. To make it short, I like being here in New York, where I spent 1 year in 1999 and 2000 at the turn of the century to study at New York University and be back in town. Now, I'm staying in Washington for a month to conduct research on Korea's foreign policy. But every time I get away from Washington, they have a heavy snow. So I'm a lucky man in that sense. And I'm very glad to see such a distinguished groups of people here at the Korea Society, which is working as a main conduit of channel between Korea and the U.S. and for promoting communication among the countries of two people. Ambassador Mark Minton is my good friend for a long time. I've seen him in Seoul, I've seen him in Washington, I've seen him in New York, and I even saw him in Ulaanbaatar, Mongolia, when he was serving as the ambassador there. I visited the country. I visit Mongolia every year, by the way, because I feel like, you know, I'm in a very familiar place. And we discussed Korea, U.S.-Mongolia trilateral cooperation to promote peace and prosperity in the region. I'm also glad that my good friend, my high schoolmate, Ambassador Oh Jun, is also present here. I know he has a very busy schedule and UN almost every day, and I really appreciate his graceful presence here. I'm also grateful to Mr. Stephen Norpa, who is my NYU schoolmate, and also the Vice President of Korea Society. I'm very glad to meet with you. And I'm very glad to meet with Martin Newden, who was ambassador in Korea, served in Korea 3-4 times, is very much loved by Korean people. And now he works for the UN expert panel on the UN sanctions on North Korea. He made an excellent report, Cheongcheon-gang case, which was very instructive to so many people. And also I'm glad to see my good friend Fiona in New York, and Mr. Ilichev from the United Nations, and thank you very much. I'm going to show you some images of Korea in its foreign relations and to share with you some thoughts that I have, and also entertain some questions from the audience. Now I'm in U.S. To research on Korean foreign policy, but many people ask me, what's happening with your relationship with Japan? Let me elaborate on my view on Korea-Japan relations sometime later. But before that, I would like to talk about Korea and Korean democracy. This is a Korean democracy at the spot, on the field, that we have changed government several times. And we used to work for democracy and human rights. But in Korea now, political democracy is taken for granted. And now we talk about economic democratization following the political democratization. Korea is a very dynamic country with the rule of law and the freedom of press and also desire for more democracy. Now the British organization called Economist Intelligence Unit comes out with an assessment on the global democracy every 2 years. And they have reviewed 167 countries upon the 5 categories, including political election transparency, the government function, political participation, and civic rights, and so on. South Korea comes up to ranking 20. And it's very surprising that Korea is ahead of the United States of America. What happened to your country? Okay. Korea saved its independence because of the U.S. support, U.N. support back in 70 years. But in the Korean democracy is growing, very vibrant, and even ahead of Japan, which is number 23. So you can say that Korean democracy is actually leading democracy in Asia. We are a pioneer. Now, the worst regime, the so-called authoritarian regimes, the list is here. The Myanmar is now in the process of opening and reform. Laos, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Syria, and finally North Korea. Out of 167 countries, North Korea is at the bottom. So this is same Korea, so far apart in their political ideology, in their socio-cultural orientation, and in terms of the degree of democracy. So there is one reason why it's not easy and difficult to conduct dialogue and communication with North Korea, but that's inevitable. We have to have the patience, we have to have the principle, and we have to have the future vision of our communication with North Korea. Korea is also a very wired country. It's a digital democracy to the extent that political parties feel very threatened by the technological advancement of the smartphones, USBs, and satellite communications. The original role of the political parties is to find out the public opinion, where it is going, and to relay it back to public opinion. But right now, this digital communication is running much faster than the political parties. So I think that is a big challenge to the modern democracy. But anyway, in the case of Korea, the usage of the smartphone is perhaps the highest per population in the world. And also turnover of the smartphone is also the fastest. The young people change their smartphone models every 6 months, every 1 year, whenever the new model comes out with more functions and more effective communication. And I think that this should be a very strong foundation for an advanced digital democracy in Asia. And certainly Korea, I think, is leading. Now, if you look at the global power of the countries, there is a very interesting criterion. And how many countries satisfy the two conditions? One is the per capita GNP, which is over $20,000, so-called 20K. And the population over 50 million. How many countries in the world can satisfy these two conditions? There are only seven, starting from Japan, US, France, Italy, Germany, UK in 1996. It took Korea more than 16 years to join this club. So from this category, Korea is one of the number seven, one of the seven biggest economy and the population in the world. President Park Geun-hye, whom I used to work together in the Korean parliament for 10 years, is the first female president of the country. And I think that this fact has contributed to the promotion of Korea in terms of ranking of democracy ahead of US and Japan. I hope someday in the US you will have a female president, and also in Japan too. She has committed herself to the economic democratization, the election commitment I mentioned, and also very actively pursuing the economic revitalization through creative economy. Now, people ask me, what is creative economy? Because economy is supposed to be creative anyway. That's true. But what she means by creative economy is the synergy between research and development, science and technology on the one hand, and commercial applications through IT on the other. So by combining these two sectors without compartmentalization, you can produce synergy. And Korea is very strong at IT plus the cultural contents. So there are lots of potential for the Korean economy to get more creative and more vibrant. And this is a picture of President Park talking with members of the foreign investors, including AmCham, in the Blue House. Looking at Korea's global FTA network, and I drew these pictures, put Korea in the center of the universe, and then see how Korean free trade network is diversified. You have USA on the one side, CORUS FTA, and European Union on the left side, Korea EU FTA. Korea is an only Asian country which has FTA with both America and Europe. And now we are discussing, we are negotiating with China. China is the second biggest economy in the world and the largest trade partner of Korea. And our trade with China, which was more than $260 billion last year, is even greater than Korea-US trade and Korea-Japan trade combined. So this is a tough nut to crack. And if Korea-China trade negotiation is completed, Korea will be an only country in the world that has trade, free trade relationship with all three major economies, US, China, and Europe. And certainly many other countries will follow suit, but for the time being, Korea is leading the global diversification of the FTA. We do have FTA with India. When I was a chairman of Foreign Affairs and Trade Committee, I went to India and met with the Indian Minister of Commerce, Mr. Sharma, and also with other Indian businessmen. They have a lot of expectation about the synergy between the Indian economy and the Korean economy. The Indian companies have invested into Korea, Mahindra and Mahindra, and Tata groups try to expand their operation in Korea. We do have FTA with ASEAN as a whole, the 10 countries in ASEAN with 600 million population, even greater than a European Union, growing by 6% on average with young age of 30 years old. ASEAN has a great potential, not only for themselves, but also for Korea as well. We regard ASEAN as the post-China market. As Chinese economy grows, doing business in China is becoming a challenge to many Korean companies because of the regulations, the environmental regulation, and also the rising wage rate. So obviously, ASEAN is waiting for us there. There's already many Korean companies are in the area. Recently, we have concluded FTA with Canada and Australia. So we are waiting for Mexico, New Zealand, and other countries to follow suit. With Japan, apart from the political uncomfortable situation, we have had not so impressive progress in our bilateral trade for FTA negotiations because of the maybe reasons on both sides. Japan is very reluctant to open its market, not only to Korea, but also to US as well, especially agricultural market. Korea is demanding about 90%. Japan is coming up with about 56% or 60%. And also on the Korean side, we have also concern about the Japanese advanced industrial engineering capability and also growing competition between the two economies. So we can somehow overcome these challenges and come to terms with each other on accomplishing our bilateral FTA. If in case our bilateral FTA with Japan doesn't make any meaningful progress, the other alternative is for Korea to join the TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, in a wider multilateral perspective. By doing so, we have the effect of having free trade negotiation with Japan, Mexico, and other countries too. I will talk about this later. If you look at Asia-Pacific area in a wider perspective, in a macro perspective, you have two different multilateral framework growing. On the one hand, on the eastern side, is an Asian FTA with Korea, China, Japan, ASEAN, plus three countries, India, Australia, and New Zealand. So it's 16 countries altogether, which we call RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, without the United States, without America, without Latin America. And on the right side, you have TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership, 12 countries, but without China and Korea so far. Now, these two multilateral free trade networks are in a kind of counterbalancing relationship with each other. But I think that for the sake of the entire region, for peace and prosperity, eventually, I think that these two should emerge. And then we should have a strategic vision to move towards this greater Asia-Pacific free trade zone. Because Asia-Pacific free trade zone without China, I think, is unthinkable. It's impractical. But at the same time, we need China to open up and liberalize. So for the time being, Korea is playing that leverage role. We want to apply the same level of highly liberalized trade regime with China because we have the knowledge and experience of wrapping up the Korea-US free trade negotiations. I know that in the United States, you have concern about the FTA implementation, the CORUS implementation. I met with the people in AmCham in Washington, and I was told that US has concern about the implementation aspects of the CORUS FTA. And I think that we can certainly overcome these challenges through frank discussions and based on our original idea of creating partnership between the two countries. So Korea will certainly play its role to open up and reform and promote the level of liberalization of the China market. So eventually, when China wants to join the TPP, the entire regional free trade network, it would be easier for them, and it would be easier for the existing members to embrace China in the long term. Now, Korea-U.S. alliance has been there for 61 years. This year is the 61st year. And I think that we have to prepare for another 60 years for the future. This is not just a bilateral relationship, but also developing global partnership as well. This alliance has been very effective, very resilient, and very flourishing. It has been very successful in preventing another war on the Korean Peninsula and also contributing to peace and stability in the region. So they declared a new vision for the strategic comprehensive alliance between the two countries. President Park gave a speech at the U.S. Congress in English, and she was very much greeted by the Korean community in New York. We have Mr. Kim Gi-cho sitting over there. This is the man sitting in the middle over there, Mr. Kim. And then Vice President Joe Biden came to Korea in the Blue House, and they look like a real close family, aren't they? So I think this is a spirit of Korea-U.S. alliance. Now, the new mission of the Korea-U.S. alliance should be to accomplish Korean unification to the extent that the alliance was successful in preventing the major breakout of the major war. Now, the next stage is naturally moving toward Korean unification, and I think that Korea should sit in a driver's seat and consult with the United States very closely to move towards the common vision, excuse me, for unification. About China, Mr. Xi Jinping very warmly received President Park Geun-hye. They are about the same age. And President Xi Jinping has a very good understanding of the situation in the Korean Peninsula, and he certainly wants to promote Korea-China partnership. From the Korean viewpoint, we want to have a meaningful strategic dialogue with China, not only for bilateral relationship, but also to persuade North Korea to open up and reform and to participate in the growing international community in Northeast Asia. China certainly has a leverage that no other countries have. They're providing energy and food to North Korea. So we want China to play more active role, more proactive role in persuading North Korea to make a right choice. And President Xi Jinping mentioned that he will be willing to cooperate with South Korea to move towards denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, which to us means denuclearization of North Korea, and to move towards more global cooperation. President Park gave a speech in the Tsinghua Daxie, Tsinghua University, in Chinese language. Many people were enthusiastically welcoming her in that speech. And also China has opened a new memorial hall to commemorate Mr. An Jung-gun, the Korean independent activist who shot Mr. Ito Hirobumi at Halpin Station. Now you all know that that incident was a kind of turning point in the relationship between Korea and Japan, and maybe for China too. Originally, President Park, when she met with President Xi Jinping, asked for Chinese support to erect a monument epitaph. On the spot, China came out with a memorial hall, which was beyond our expectation. Why China did it? Perhaps it is related to the Japanese action, which I will come later. Now, Korea-Japan partnership with a question mark. The two leaders, also of the similar age, and they always sit side by side because by the alphabetical order, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, J, K. I think that's our unavoidable destiny between the two countries that you're not only located right across the sea, we call it East Sea, Japan called it Sea of Japan, but also they sit together in every international summit meeting, but they don't talk with each other. Why? Because of the history issue. Now, some people tell me that, why is Korea so obsessed with the history? Why can you go forward? Because history might impair the relationship with other countries, alliance, and Korea-Japan relationship. I do hear that question many times. And I say to my friends that, look, if you look at the Korean history, what is left is our desire for independence. How can you talk about Korea without talking about history? So we cannot forget our history. Maybe we can forgive the countries and the people which have done a lot of wrongdoings to Korea, but we cannot forget our history, and that should be the basis upon which we can move forward to the future. And we hope that our neighbors, whether it's Japan or China, might agree with us in having a common understanding of the significance of the history and learn the lessons together and move forward. That is missing between Korea and Japan. Now, fortunately, Prime Minister Abe, who was kind of unclear about whether his cabinet could inherit the statement made by the former Prime Minister, Prime Minister Murayama, and the Chief of Staff, Mr. Kono, in the past or not, was very unclear. At some point, he said, the definition of invasion is different depending on which perspective you look at it. And his Chief of State came out and said, we need to review the Kono statement in terms of factual truth or not. But fortunately, a couple of days ago, a Prime Minister came out in the Diet and stated that he will respect the spirit of all these statements, Murayama, Kono, and Koizumi, which is well done, well said. But more important thing is for Japan to move beyond words and clarify its position through action, the genuine action towards Korea and China. Now, President Park Geun-hye initiated Northeast Asian Peace and Cooperation, 동북아 평화협력 구상. Now, I put President Park Geun-hye higher because she's my president. And the two gentlemen are kind of supporting President Park. I like this picture. I hope that three countries in the region can come to terms with each other, whether it's history, whether it's a future vision, whether it's a cultural communication for the next generation. We have enormous tasks to accomplish. If Britain, France, and Germany in Europe could come to terms with each other after two bloody wars in the 20th century to create a common understanding and common textbook and a genuine repentance about the wrongdoings which was afflicted to the people in the past, why not Korea, China, and Japan? Here is our British ambassador sitting over there. So I think we should do it, and the only way that we can achieve this common historical understanding is to look at the historical facts and admit the problems, the wrongdoings, and build from then on. When the German chancellor, Willy Brandt, went to the Holocaust epitaph of the Jewish people, he laid a flower and prayed for the souls who were killed during the war. It gave emotional, touching experience to many people. And also the German chancellor, Angela Merkel, also did the same. Why not Japanese leaders do so? Especially we have the comfort women who are still alive in their age of 85, 86, 87, 89. Only 55 of them are left. So the spirit of trilateral cooperation should flourish. And fortunately, we have the working level trilateral cooperation secretariat based in Seoul, Jongno, my hometown, my birthplace. What they do is to sit down every day and talk about mutual cooperation, whether it's history or whether it's textbook or whether it's environmental pollution or climate change and nuclear safety or cultural communication. This is great. I think this is a start of the blossoming of the Northeast Asian Peace and Cooperation. And I commend these three diplomats from three countries very highly. They are doing a very important job and very difficult job of coming to terms with each other. Now, the history issue. Last Christmas, Prime Minister Abe suddenly visited the Yasukuni Shrine. And that was totally unexpected. We were taken aback in Korea, especially when U.S. President Joe Biden visited Korea, came to Seoul, and assured us that Japan will refrain from provoking other countries in the region. And that was understanding between him and the Japanese leadership. So only a few days later, he just made a surprise visit. I think that many Japanese people were surprised as well. I think this is a wrong idea of coming to terms with each other, because the shrine is not just a shrine, but it has enshrined the 14 class war criminals from the Pacific War. And that still remains in the memory of Korean people very vividly. So it doesn't help to repair the wounded relationship. Comfort women, which I mentioned, they protest to the Japanese government that their damage to their dignity and the honor should be apologized and should be compensated officially by the Japanese government. Still hasn't come to that point yet. The Comfort Women's statue was built in Glendale, California. There's a Kim Bok-dong, Halmoni, is sitting with the Comfort Women. So I'm trying to emphasize that President Obama's visit to Korea and Japan next month should be not only a makeup diplomatic trip, but also a catalyst for improving the relationship between Korea and Japan. United States, as a common ally of these two key Asian partners, is in a position to play its proactive role in mending the fences, improving the situation, and bridging the gap between the two sides. U.S.-Korean alliance, as I mentioned, successful one, is flourishing, should go forward. U.S.-Japan alliance has become even closer. And they have to deal with the rising power and influence of China in the region. So the rationale for trilateral cooperation is very important, and it's also growing. So it is very unfortunate that at a time when we need a very viable cooperation among three countries, we are faced with this history issue and a stalemate between Korea and Japan. So I will ask President Obama to have a more forward-looking, creative vision and to express message to the Japanese people that they need to make a right choice in the history and improve the situation with Korea. And also, I think that Korea should reciprocate with Prime Minister Abe's statement in the Diet and also with the U.S. proactive role. We should positively consider the meeting in The Hague, Netherlands, on the occasion of the Nuclear Security Summit for three leaders to get together and talk about our common issue, talk about regional peace and security, and talk about the future of Northeast Asia. I think these are the responsibilities of the politicians, of the national leaders, to move in that direction. Now, Russia. Obviously, all the media attention is on Ukraine. I visited Ukraine twice, lovely country, friendly people, very proud. And I'm very sorry that this country is now undergoing intolerable suffering and almost the danger of being split into East and West. And I hope that United Nations and many countries which love freedom and democracy should help Ukraine to stay hold together instead of being split. But anyway, between Russia and Korea, we have enormous potential that we can harness in terms of railway and in terms of natural gas supply project. The idea is to get natural gas from Sakhalin all the way to through North Korea and down to South Korea. This is a kind of trilateral energy cooperation in Northeast Asia. Russia will sell its own natural gas North Korea may get the transit fee, whether in cash or in material, or South Korea will secure its energy supply from Russia. So for three countries, this is a triple win game. Why not do it? We hope this can be realized at this time. The other idea is to link Korean Peninsula all the way to the South and North and to the Trans-Siberian Railway, all the way to Moscow, and then through Eurorail, go to London by train from Busan. Martin, do you like it? If you like it, please clap hands for this. You know, Korea is like an island now. We are blocked by North Korea. Now, we always call Japanese, you islanders, but we are actually islanders too. So we need to unify the country and get through this demarcation between the two sides and be connected to China and Russia. In China, you have three northeast Chinese provinces, the Liaoning, the Jilin, and the Heilongjiang. They have 120 million people there, half-time larger than the entire Korean Peninsula, and also eastern Siberia. And Russia needs desperately investment and economic presence of Korea in the region. So this is waiting for us. And this can only be done by integrating two Korean economies to get connected with China and Russia. And this is so-called the Eurasia Initiative that President Park Geun-hye has initiated, which I think is very forward-looking and very important. Korea-Europe partnership is also growing. As I mentioned, we have the FTA with European Union. And even though Europe, especially Southern Europe, is going through sovereign financial difficulties, Korea will be an eternal partner of Europe in terms of trade investment, but also in terms of political democracy and human rights as well. Climate change, not to mention. President Park met with Queen Elizabeth II, Her Majesty, and also President Hollande in France, and also met with Angela Merkel, the German Chancellor, already five times. And she's now visiting Germany again next week, together with participation in the nuclear summit. And in Germany, the country which has accomplished historic unification, she will announce some ideas about how she can bring the Korean Peninsula towards unification. I think that this will be a very important milestone diplomatic activity of President Park soon to come. Now, I mentioned ASEAN already, 10 countries in ASEAN, Indonesia, Vietnam, Philippines, Thailand, and Myanmar also. This year, Korea is going to hold a special summit, ASEAN summit, by inviting all the 10 countries from the area and get together to talk about future Korea-ASEAN partnership. The country, the group has enormous potential. And also Korea is now individually negotiating with the countries in ASEAN, especially Indonesia and Vietnam. You know, Indonesia is the largest, in a way, shareholder of the ASEAN group, almost 40% of GNP, 40% of population. It's a Muslim country. And the Korean companies are already operating in Indonesia. And we have lots of potential partnership that we can move forward. And with Vietnam, many Korean companies are already in the area, and we share Confucian culture as well. The Korean movie, drama, K-pop, K-fashion, K-food, very popular in all these countries, Vietnam, Indonesia. So Korean foreign policy is very strongly buttressed by the cultural strengths of Korea through Hallyu, the Korean wave. And I think that young generation, including young people in this room, will certainly look forward to Korea's active engagement in Asia through the cultural dialogue. India, she met with Manmohan Singh recently, with a country with a 1.2 billion population, the largest democracy in the world, and 3 years of FTA with Korea and India has made the trade and investment grow by 50%. And the Indian young specialist and expert in IT who are working in the Korean company like Samsung R&D in Bangalore, the Korean Hyundai Motors in Chennai, and many other areas in India would like to have closer relationship with Korea. They want to come to Korea and to learn the culture and people. We have the legend, and I think this is a historical fact, that Indian princess Ayodhya came to Korea, married with a Korean king called Kim Su-ro in AD 48. There was a first international marriage between Korea and India. And now they have the generation after generation of families, the Hoshi family and the Kimshi, Kim Gimshi family. They don't marry with each other because they come from the same parents, we believe. So we are already in-law blood sharing friends between Korea and India. And finally, middle power diplomacy. Now this concept is a buzzword in Korea now. What's middle power? It's not strong power, it's not small power. Middle power. Korea, the combined population between South and North is like 75 million, and including 7.5 overseas Korean community will be something like 83, 84 million, a little less than Vietnam, less than Mexico. And if you take account of the similar countries in the world, it'll be like Mexico, Turkey, Indonesia, obviously 250 million population, very large, and Australia, little population, but larger GDP. The idea is to create a open, informal forum for diplomatic cooperation and the creation of the message and the synergy through economic partnership towards the global village. So these countries will think about what future vision we can create together, and if necessary, persuade the big powers in their management of the global economy, in the G20, or in the climate change forum, or the nuclear security summit, to move forward. And this is a beginning of the Korean middle power diplomacy, and I think that many countries will join this group later too. Now, let me conclude with inter-Korean relationship, which is really the main point here. Now, President Park Geun-hye, in her foreign affairs article, mentioned two things, realignment and the trust politic. She said, whether it's hard line or whether it's soft line, we need some sort of a vision and philosophy to get engaged with North Korea in a meaningful way, and the basic requirement is to build trust. Now, how can you pursue dialogue without really trusting each other? North Korea came out with a kind of positive message in the beginning of the year. They said, we are ready to talk with the South. We are concerned about the economic livelihood of the people, and we'll be happy to talk with the South. Still, the country maintains military first policy, like this. And the new leader, Kim Jong-un, is at the top, you know, obviously running the country with the top power elites. If you see the people on the podium on the day of the military parade, you have Mr. Lee Yong-ho, chief of staff, and Mr. Choi Ryong-hae, who is now the number two man, apparently, and also Mr. Chang Sang-taek, who got executed. So out of three power, closest power elite, two are gone. The execution of Chang Sang-taek, as I mentioned, was total surprise to Korea, and I think China was certainly perplexed by this action by North Korea and many other countries too. And especially Mr. Chang Sang-taek, the second powerful man in the North Korean power hierarchy, was an intermediary of economic partnership between North Korea and China. So from Chinese viewpoint, didn't make any sense. So they are very concerned about the impact of Chang Sang-taek's execution. But North Korea looks like it's business as usual. So Kim Jong-un clapping hands in front of the people who represents the agricultural cooperatives in North Korea. But continues to fire missiles. As we seen only 2 days ago on Sunday, they fired about 25 frog-style missiles to the Eastern Sea. And North Korea tends to do it on Sunday time in the United States, because everyone is having a, you know, relaxed time and they want peace, but the firing of the missile irritates many people. And it comes as a surprise. And they did the same this time too. So what else will come? Nobody knows. And I think that although in North Korea, things look like business as usual, and I think that nobody is safe in North Korea, maybe including the leader himself. And I think that in the long term, there's uncertainty and vulnerability. If some political change transpires in North Korea, is there any check and balance mechanism to make it stable? I don't think so. So we need to watch very carefully and see what is going to unfold in North Korea. Obviously, we want North Korea to move towards reform and opening up and economic development. But there is no guarantee. Now, Kaesong Industrial Complex, which was shut down unilaterally by the North Korean power elite, including the military, has been resumed, and their operation has come up to almost a normal level. As I understand, about 123 Korean companies are operating in the factory, and more than 50,000 people are in work. This is an idea of North Korean economic planners to move towards economic development. About 14 areas in North Korea, including Kaesong Industrial Complex, have been designed to be designated as a main point of economic, special economic zone. I wish it can happen. And in order for this plan to be materialized, certainly you need international economic support and investment, including South Korea ourselves. So President Park came out in the press conference and she said, unification is daebak. Daebak in Korean means great fortune. Someone says jackpot or bonanza, but you know, jackpot is it's like slot machine. And you just push the button, the money comes out. I don't think it's the case. Bonanza is like finding a gold mine and all of a sudden you become a rich man. I don't think it's the right notion. I think it's a great fortune for both South and North Korea and all the entire region as well because of the synergy that has been hidden because of the division of the country. We have to pay the cost of the division. It is not well considered in our concept of the unification. So I think that we have to change the way of thinking about unification in favor of more positive outcome resulting from the unification. Now, inter-Korean dialogue was conducted recently to resume dialogue with North Korea. Family reunion of the separated families took place. It's a very touching, emotional encounter between the families who have been separated for many years. So Korean unification, these are the countries in the six-party talks. And you know the six-party talks has been practically suspended. I think the reason is because of the different ideas and different dreams. We call it same bed, different dreams. 동상 이몽, call it. From South Korean viewpoint, we take six-party talks as 2+4. Two are the two Koreas. Four are the other countries, U.S., China, Russia, and Japan. The most important thing in the six-party talks, from our viewpoint, is for the Koreans to talk to each other and come to agreement on denuclearization and unification. Well, North Korea seems to have a different view. They also think six-party talks is 2+4, but their two is North Korea and the United States. And the other are four. So we talk about same 2+4, but different dreams and different ideas. I think that's the reason why six-party talks has not been making as much result as possible and as much as people would have expected. But despite this differences of perspectives, we should move towards unification, peaceful unification, and I think that's the idea of President Park Geun-hye. She's not thinking about instantaneous absorption of North Korea, and she's not thinking about the German model as well. Because German model was instantaneous unification by the crumbling down of the Berlin Wall. And of course, it took many years for Germany to reach that point through constant communication and exchange of visits. But in the case of Korea, we are so far apart in terms of social system, political ideology, economic level, that it takes time for us to assimilate two Koreas to reduce the gap. And I think the first step would be step-by-step economic and cultural integration, trade, investment, and human exchange, and humanitarian assistance towards North Korea. And then the difficult part, the difficult stage of integration will come through political, military confidence-building process, through dialogues and arms reduction. In the meantime, refugees from North Korea keeps growing, and we have almost 27,000, 28,000 North Korean refugees who have already settled down in the South. So in a sense, small-scale unification is already occurring in Korea. And if you do not accommodate and embrace the growing number of North Korean refugees, how can we accomplish the large-scale unification eventually in the future? This is very important. And I think that if there is a lesson that we can learn from German unification, the most important lesson is that the East German people themselves chose unification because they thought that united Germany would be a better place to live for them than the divided Germany. And in the case of Korea, same is the case in my view, although contexts are different, modalities of unification might be different. But the essential aspect of the unification is that North Korean people themselves have some kind of conviction that united Korea will be a better place for them to live than the divided Korea. And in order to do that, we need to make efforts on our own part, which is to provide outside information to North Korea and provide economic assistance so that they can understand what is going on outside and understand also the reality of the Korean Peninsula. Now, there is a Korea Development Institute in Korea, which looks at the economic prospects, and they predict what is going to happen in the Korean Peninsula. They came out with four reports recently, all point to the possible unification and the practical scenarios of moving towards unified Korea. One of the models is a China-Taiwan model, that although there is a political differences, China and Taiwan are practically one economy. People have mutual communication, mutual investment, mutual visits, and the mutual economic prosperity. So why not Korea, despite the political problems? The United States National Intelligence Council, as you know, comes out with a report every 4 years. And the last one, the one before last, the 2025 one, they say Korea will be unified by 2025, and it will be a big economy. And in the latest one, the new assessment came out recently. It says that Korea will move towards unification, but there will be very competitive competition between U.S. and China with regard to the future of Korea being unified. And I think that that means that we need to persuade China to cooperate with the Korean unification rather than maintaining the current policy of status quo on the Korean Peninsula, which means that continuation of the division of the Korean Peninsula, which is not in our interest. So that requires Korea-US alliance, cooperation, and support. And that's why I mentioned at the beginning that the new mission of Korea-US alliance, which has survived 60 years of ups and downs, is to move towards Korean unification together. Now, Russia is also very straightforward, in a way, about Korean unification. The E-Memo, the Institute of World Economies and International Relations, came out with a report in 2011, the title 2030 in the World. And they said 3 points. One, unification will continue during 2011 to 2030. So we are already now in that stage. Two, economic integration will gradually take place during the 20s. And three, and this is most interesting, Korean unification under the leadership of South Korea will bring benefits to Russia. Clear cut. And this is my final picture. This is by the Goldman Sachs. Came out in 2009, paper number 188. It said, if Korea is unified, it'll be the number 7 economy in the world. Here is 2050, but I think that the practical possibility will be much earlier than that. Now, Korean economy is now slowly growing, but somewhere in 2016, it'll begin to flat down because of the low birth rate. The population will shrink. The aging society is the most difficult long-term challenge of Korean society, as well as the national division. In order to make a breakthrough to this aging society problems, unification is perhaps the most effective way of revitalizing the Korean demographic structure and create synergy. Now, if you look at the countries here, China has become very big, US is second, India, Brazil, Russia, Indonesia, and Mexico. All these 7 countries have the population over 100 million people. Number 8, United Korea is an only country out of 8 nations which has population under 100 million. That's very exceptional. But the synergy of unified Korea will certainly be noticed on this picture. In case Korea remains divided, you see on the right side in a red box, that South Korea will be somewhere on the 15th or 16th. In between, there are countries like United Kingdom, Turkey, Japan, France, Germany, Nigeria, Philippines, Canada, Italy. So I ask students in my class at Hankuk University of Foreign Studies, which Korea do you want? And they say, unified Korea. So I said, how much tax are you going to pay? And they say, maybe not now. Sometime later, because I have to get my job first. So this is a mixed feeling among young Koreans in Korea now that although they support unification by principle and by their wish, but the practical accomplishment of unification through active participation is still there's some distance. And I think that it is the task of the Park Geun-hye government to change this negative antipathy toward unification into a more positive one so that Korea can move towards unification with confidence and with expectation. And thank you for your patience. Thank you very much.
Please, a warm round of applause. Thank you.
I think all of us can agree after that magnificent, and thank you very much for taking questions. Hour-long presentation, which covered the waterfront, we say diplomatically a tour d'horizon, that we all wish, and we believe too, that Dr. Park and some guys we do not yet know will have a large role in Korea's foreign policy and in Korean-U.S. relations in the future. Not only hope for that, I completely believe that will be the case. So thank you again. This is a small token of our appreciation, a catalog of one of our gallery programs.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
If I may say one last word, toward the end of this presentation, there was quite a lot of discussion of the UN report on human rights in North Korea, UN Commission report. We actually have a full program on that Thursday, the 27th of March, about a week and a half from now, at, again, 12 o'clock in the afternoon, preceded very much like this by something to eat, about 11:45. If you're interested in that program, please sign up. Please come. The speaker will be Frank Januzzi, who is the head of the Washington Office of Amnesty International. Again, he will be reviewing the United Nations Commission report on human rights violations in North Korea. Many of you may know that Frank Januzzi, before he took the job at Amnesty International, was previously the foreign policy advisor to Joseph Biden. So thank you very much again to our speaker, Dr. Geun-hye. Thank you all for coming. Hope to see you again soon.